Hello everybody. Welcome to our YouTube channel number 1 Doctor. Today we have a medical exam discussion with one of the candidates. Every question have 4 options. You should choose one answer and explain why you choose it. Hello. Are you ready? Can we start the exam now?
Yes doctor, I am ready. We can start.
The left spermatic vein drains into the A. left iliac vein. B. left inferior epigastric vein. C. left side of the inferior vena cava. D. left renal vein.
The correct answer is D. The right spermatic vein drains directly into the inferior vena cava. On the left, the spermatic vein drains into the left renal vein.
Patients with bladder stones are at increased risk for which of the following bladder cancers? A. Adenocarcinoma. B. Transitional cell carcinoma. C. Squamous cell carcinoma. D. Choriocarcinoma.
The correct answer is C. Squamous cell carcinoma. The most common form of bladder cancer in the United States is transitional cell carcinoma TCC. Tobacco use, followed by occupational exposure to various carcinogenic materials such as automobile exhaust or industrial solvents are the most frequent risk factors, though many with the disease have no identifiable risks. Other forms of bladder cancer, such as adenocarcinoma and squamous cell carcinoma, occur in distinct patient populations. Patients with chronic irritation from catheters, bladder stones, or schistosomiasis infection are at risk for the squamous cell variant, while those with urachal remnants or bladder extrophy have an increased risk of adenocarcinoma.
Emphysematous pyelonephritis is most commonly caused by A. Clostridia perfringens. B. Escherichia coli. C. Group A streptococcus. D. Bacteroides species.
The correct answer is B. Escherichia coli. Emphysematous pyelonephritis is a life-threatening infection that results from complicated pyelonephritis by gas-producing organisms. It is an acute necrotizing infection of the kidney that occurs predominantly in diabetic patients. Patients frequently present with sepsis and ketoacidosis. Escherichia coli appears to be the most frequent organism responsible for this infection. Patients require supportive care, IV antibiotics, and relief of any urinary tract obstruction. Emphysematous pyelonephritis can be subdivided based on extent of infection. Those with gas confined to the parenchyma frequently can be managed conservatively with placement of a nephrostomy tube to allow drainage of purulent material. Patients with extensive involvement of the perirenal tissue may not respond to conservative management, and strong consideration should be given to expeditious nephrectomy, particularly if the patient is displaying signs of sepsis.
Expectant management may be considered for men with prostate cancer who A. have a Gleason score greater than 10. B. are less than 55 years of age. C. have low volume disease as determined by biopsy. D. have a PSA level less than 35.
The correct answer is C. have low volume disease as determined by biopsy. Expectant management may be a useful strategy in men with anticipated survival of less than 10 years, low Gleason score is less than or equal to 6, early stage disease CT1C, and small volume disease as determined by biopsy. Patients should be watched closely with digital rectal exam, PSI testing, and repeat biopsy at 1 year to assess the possible progression of disease. Prostate cancer is graded according to the Gleason scoring system. A primary and secondary score are assigned based on the most common and second most common histologic pattern. Grades run from 1 for the most differentiated to 5 for the least. The grades are added to give the Gleason score. In current practice, scores below 6 are almost never assigned. Gleason score, preoperative PSI level, and digital rectal exam are used to estimate the likelihood of whether the cancer is localized, locally advanced, or metastatic. Prostate cancer with high Gleason scores 8 to 10 or a high PSI level greater than 20 is much more likely to have spread, often at a micrometastatic level.
A blunt injury to the kidney with a 2 cm non-expanding hematoma and a small amount of urinary extravasation is A. A grade 1 injury. B. A grade 2 injury. C. A grade 3 injury. D. A grade 4 injury.
The correct answer is D. A grade 4 injury. Any injury that involves the collecting system implied by the urinary leak is a grade 4 injury.
Injuries to the distal ureter should be treated with A. Primary repair. B. End-to-end anastomosis after spatulation. C. Ureteroureterostomy to the contralateral ureter. D. Ureteral reimplantation.
The correct answer is D. Ureteral reimplantation. Surgical repair depends on location and extent of injury. A suture in place briefly may be removed, usually without consequence. Partial injuries can be primarily repaired, although all devitalized tissue must be debrided to avoid delayed tissue breakdown and urinoma formation. Ureteral stents should be placed in this situation to facilitate healing without stricture. Lower ureteral injuries below the iliac vessels are best treated with ureteral reimplant, as the blood supply can be tenuous and strictures are more common with a distal ureteroureterostomy. Midureteral level injuries can be treated with a ureteroureterostomy if a spatulated, tension-free repair can be achieved. For longer defects, the bladder can be mobilized and brought up to the source muscle, source hitch. For additional length, a tubularized flap of bladder, body flap can be created and anastomosed to the remaining ureter. Renal mobilization with nephropexy by anchoring to the source muscle can provide additional length. Autotransplantation, transureteroureterostomy, and allele ureter are rarely needed during an acute setting.
Elevated serum levels of alpha-fetoprotein in a man with a firm testicular mass make which of the following diagnoses most likely? A. Seminomatous germ cell tumor. B. Non-seminomatous germ cell tumor. C. Leydig cell tumor. D. Sertoli cell tumor.
The correct answer is B. Non-seminomatous germ cell tumor. All solid testicular masses observed on physical examination and documented on ultrasound are malignant until proven otherwise, because the vast majority are cancerous. Initial studies must include tumor markers, including alpha-fetoprotein and beta-human chorionic gonadotrophin. Elevated tumor markers are found almost exclusively in non-seminomatous germ cell tumor, though occasionally seminomas will cause a modest rise in beta-human chorionic gonadotrophin. Most testicular neoplasms arise from the germ cells, though Nongam cell tumors arise from Leydig's or Sertoli's cells. The Nongam cell tumors are rare and generally follow a more benign course. Germ cell cancers are categorically divided into seminomatous and non-seminomatous forms that follow different treatment algorithms.
Which of the following types of renal calculi will not be seen on CT scan? A. Calcium oxalate. B. Struvite, magnesium ammonium phosphate. C. Uric acid. D. Crystalline excreted endinavir.
The correct answer is D. Crystalline excreted endinavir. Urolithiasis, or urinary calculus disease, may affect up to 10% of the population over the course of a lifetime. Calculi are crystalline aggregates of one or more components, most commonly calcium oxalate. They also may contain calcium phosphate, magnesium ammonium phosphate, struvite, uric acid, or cysteine. Calcium and struvite containing stones often are visible on plain radiographs, but CT scans will demonstrate all calculi except those composed of crystalline excreted endinavir, an antiretroviral medication.
A patient with renal cell carcinoma with extension into the IVC, tumor thrombus, is best treated with A. Radiotherapy. B. Chemotherapy. C. Thrombolytic therapy. D. Surgery.
The correct answer is D. Surgery. Up to 10% of RCC invades the lumen of the renal vein or vena cava. The degree of venous extension directly impacts the surgical approach. Patients with thrombus below the level of the liver can be managed with cross-clamping above and below the thrombus and extraction from a cavotomy at the insertion of the renal vein. Usually, the thrombus is not adherent to the vessel wall. However, cross-clamping the vena cava above the hepatic veins can drastically reduce cardiac preload, and therefore, bypass techniques often are necessary. For thrombus above the hepatic veins, a multidisciplinary approach with either venovenous or cardiopulmonary bypass is necessary. In cases of invasion of the wall of the vena cava or atrium, deep hypothermic circulatory arrest may be used to give a completely bloodless field. Tumor thrombus embolization to the pulmonary artery is a rare but known complication during these cases and is associated with a high mortality. For cases of extensive tumor thrombus, intraoperative transesophageal echocardiography should be considered for monitoring and assessment of possible thrombus embolization. If a thrombus embolization occurs, a stenotomy cardiopulmonary bypass with extraction of the thrombus may be life-saving.
The most common noncontinent urinary diversion procedure after cystectomy is A. Orthotopic neobladder, ileal pouch. B. Ileal conduit. C. Appendiceal conduit. D. Ureterostomy.
The correct answer is B. Allele conduit. Patients have multiple reconstructive options, including continent and non-continent urinary diversions following cystectomy. The orthotopic neobladder has emerged as a popular urinary diversion for patients without urethral involvement. This diversion type involves the detubularization of a segment of bowel, typically distal ileum, which is then refashioned into a pouch that is anastomosed to the proximal urethral. Detubularization decreases intra-pouch filling pressure, which improves urinary storage capacity. The external sphincter is still intact, and voiding is achieved through sphincteric relaxation and a Valsalva's maneuver. The most common non-continent diversion is the allele conduit, whereby a segment of distal ileum is isolated with one end brought out through the abdominal wall as a urostomy. Allele conduits are preferred for renal insufficiency because urine is not stored, and therefore has less time in contact with the absorptive surface of the allele segment. Conduits are also used when the bladder is unresectable, but urinary diversion is necessary due to intractable bleeding or severe voiding pain. Each segment of bowel that is used offers its own advantages and inherent complications.
Initial management of a patient with priapism includes A. Bed rest, narcotics, and hydration. B. Administration of beta blockers. C. Placement of an 18-gauge IV catheter into the corpus cavernosum. D. Surgical exploration.
The correct answer is C. Placement of an 18-gauge IV catheter into the corpus cavernosum. The management of priapism is rapid detumescence with the goal of preservation of future erectile function. The ability to achieve normal erections is directly related to length of the episode of priapism. Low-flow priapism can be confirmed with a penile blood gas of the cavernosal bodies demonstrating hypoxic, acidotic blood. Initial management can include oral agents such as pseudoephedrine or baclofen, but more aggressive measures usually are necessary to achieve rapid detumescence. Insertion of a large-gauge needle, 18-gauge, into the lateral aspect of one corporal body allows thorough aspiration and irrigation of both corporal bodies because of widely communicating channels. Injection of phenylephrine up to 200 mg in 20 ml normal saline into the corporal bodies may be required. For those with sickle cell disease, hydration and oxygen administration should be performed first, as that is sometimes successful in this group.
A patient with a complex pelvic fracture is scheduled for open reduction and fixation of the fractures in the operating room. He also has an extraperitoneal bladder injury with a contained area of extravasation. The best treatment for the bladder injury is A. Leaving a Foley catheter in place for 7 to 10 days. B. Percutaneous drainage of the extravasation and Foley catheter drainage of the bladder. C. Transurethral repair of the bladder injury. D. Open repair of the bladder injury.
The correct answer is D. Open repair of the bladder injury. Extraperitoneal bladder injuries can typically be managed with catheter drainage for 7 to 10 days. If intraoperative exploration is to occur for other injuries, repair can be performed at that time. For patients with pelvic injuries that require an open operation with placement of metal hardware, repair of the bladder rupture should be performed if possible. Intraperitoneal bladder injuries should be explored immediately and repaired. However, for cases of a missed intraperitoneal injury, patients often do well with catheter drainage only. For large ruptures after repair, a suprapubic tube is recommended, but a large urethral catheter is sufficient for smaller injuries. All injuries, especially those managed non-operatively, should be followed up by a cystogram to document healing before catheter removal.
Paraphimosis refers to A. Inability to retract the foreskin. B. Inability to reduce the foreskin after it has been retracted. C. Infection of the foreskin. D. Excessive length of foreskin.
The correct answer is B. Inability to reduce the foreskin after it has been retracted. Paraphimosis is a common problem that represents a true medical emergency. When foreskin is retracted for prolonged periods, constriction of the gland's penis may ensue. This is particularly likely in hospitalized patients who are confined to bed or who have altered mentation. Edema often forms in the genitals of supine patients due to the dependent position of that area. Patients with diminished consciousness will not be aware of the penile pain from paraphimosis, which may delay recognition of the problem until too late. Delay can be catastrophic as penile necrosis may occur due to ischemia.
Which of the following is an absolute indication for surgical exploration of an injured kidney? A. Grade 5 injury. B. Large urinoma from a collecting duct injury. C. contained hematoma greater than 5 cm in diameter. D. Renovascular hypertension.
The correct answer is A. Grade 5 injury.
A patient with a complete anterior urethral injury after a high-speed motor vehicle accident is best initially managed by A. Placement of a Foley catheter for 8 to 10 days. B. Placement of a Foley catheter for 1 month. C. Placement of a suprapubic catheter. D. Immediate repair.
The correct answer is C. Placement of a suprapubic catheter. Blunt anterior urethral injury can be managed in multiple ways and only small series are available in the literature to compare methods. Immediate surgical repair is not recommended in the acute setting with the exception of low-velocity penetrating injuries. If the patient is stable with minimal hematoma formation, repair should be considered. In the setting of a 1 to 2 cm defect, the urethra can be debrided, spatulated, and anastomosed in an end-to-end, watertight fashion. Large defects should have treatment deferred, as grafts or flaps may be required for repair and the success may diminish with infections. For most cases, catheter drainage is recommended. Many advocate avoiding a placement of a urethral catheter, as it may convert a partial tear to a complete dissection. However, a single gentle passage performed by a urologist is safe. For a complete disruption, the placement of a suprapubic tube is recommended, however, a stricture at the site of injury may ensue.
Following documentation of a firm mass in the testes by ultrasound in a 32-year-old male, tissue should be obtained for diagnosis by A. Fine needle aspiration. B. Core needle biopsy. C. Open biopsy. D. Orchiectomy.
The correct answer is D. Orchiectomy. There is no role for percutaneous biopsy of testicular muscles due to the risk of seeding the scrotal wall and changing the natural retroperitoneal lymphatic drainage of the testicle, because the testes have a remarkably predictable pattern of lymphatic drainage. In cases where metastatic disease to the testicle is suspected, an open testicular biopsy by delivery of the testicle through the inguinal canal is recommended. Lymphoma may involve one or both testes, but evidence of the disease usually is present elsewhere in the body, although relapses may be isolated to the testes.
Following transurethral resection of a superficial, non-invasive, transitional cell carcinoma, which of the following is instilled in the bladder to decrease the risk of recurrence? A. Cyclophosphamide. B. Cisplatinum. C. Methotrexate. D. BCG, Bacille Calmette Guérin.
The correct answer is D. BCG, Bacille Calmette Guérin. Patients with non-muscle invasive TCC confined to the bladder mucosa or submucosa can be managed with transurethral resection alone. However, patients are at risk for recurrence and progression to muscle invasive disease. Tumor grade is extremely important in assessing the risk of disease progression. Those patients with high-grade disease or recurrent tumors can be treated with intravesical agents such as Bacille Calmette Guérin or mitomycin. See, these agents decrease risk of progression and recurrence by induction of an effective immunologic anti-tumor response in the case of Bacilli Calmette Guérin and through direct cytotoxicity for mitomycin. See, Adriamycin is actually used on occasion to prevent recurrences. Variceal cyclophosphamide is never used.
Which one of the following syndromes is associated with an increased risk of renal cell carcinoma? A. Down syndrome. B. Von Hippel-Lindau syndrome. C. Neurofibromatosis type 1. D. Osteogenesis imperfecta.
The correct answer is B. Von Hippel-Lindau syndrome. Most cases of RCC are sporadic, but many hereditary forms have been described. These syndromes frequently involve a germline mutation in a tumor suppressor gene. Von Hippel-Lindau disease is associated with multiple tumors including clear cell RCC. The involved gene, VHL, also frequently is mutated or hypermethylated in sporadic RCC. Other rare forms include Berthog-Dube syndrome, where patients get oncocytomas or chromophore tumors. Patients with hereditary papillary RCC and hereditary leiomyomatosis develop papillary RCC.
Which of the following classes of medication is the most common initial treatment of men with symptomatic benign prostatic hypertrophy, BPHA? Alpha agonist. B. Alpha blocker. C. Beta agonist. D. Beta blocker.
The correct answer is B. Alpha blocker. Medical treatment of BPH is usually the first step. Alpha blockers act on alpha receptors in the smooth muscle of the prostate and decrease its tone. 5-alpha reductase inhibitors, which block the conversion of testosterone to the more potent dihydrotestosterone, shrink the prostate over several months. blockers, and antagonists are the same thing. Agonists are us better because since they do exist but are not used for BPH.
In a patient with extensive Fournier's gangrene involving the scrotum, the testes A. are usually involved and must be resected. B. are usually involved but can be watched for 24 to 48 hours before deciding to perform an orchiectomy. C. are usually not involved but should be removed due to the potential for post-operative pain. D. are usually not involved and can be transposed to the soft tissue of the thigh.
The correct answer is D. are usually not involved and can be transposed to the soft tissue of the thigh. Prompt debridement of non-viable tissue and broad-spectrum antibiotics is necessary to prevent further spread of infection in patients with Fournier's gangrene. If there is damage to the external sphincter, patients may require a colostomy. As the testes have a separate blood supply, they are usually not threatened and do not need to be removed. They may be tucked subcutaneously into the thigh-thigh pouch to ease post-operative management. The testes are occasionally left exposed but wrapped in wet to dry dressings if there is a plan to do skin grafting in the immediate post-debridement time frame. They may be tucked subcutaneously into the thigh or left exposed wrapped in wet to dry dressings if early skin grafting is possible.
Which of the following types of renal carcinoma has the worst prognosis? A. Clear cell. B. Papillary. C. Chromophobe. D. Collecting duct.
The correct answer is D. Collecting duct. Various histologic subtypes of renal carcinoma include clear cell, papillary types IN2 chromophobe, collecting duct, and unclassified forms. Collecting duct and unclassified forms have dismal prognosis and very little response to systemic therapy.
The blood supply of the distal ureter is provided by branches of the A. aorta. B. Renal arteries. C. Lumbar arteries. D. Iliac arteries.
The correct answer is D. Iliac arteries. The blood supply of the proximal ureter derives from the aorta and renal artery and comes mainly from the medial direction. However, once it crosses the iliac vessels at the pelvic brim near where the iliac vessels bifurcate, it derives its blood supply laterally from branches from the iliac arteries. The blood supply has implications for managing ureteral injuries. Mobilizing the distal ureter for anastomosis requires releasing its lateral attachments, which results in ischemia, so for this reason, distal ureteral injuries are typically managed by bringing the proximal ureter to the bladder.
Which of the following does not supply arterial blood to the testes? A. Testicular artery. B. Deferential artery. C. Scrotal artery. D. Cremasteric artery.
The correct answer is C. Scrotal artery. The blood supply enters the testis at the superior pole by way of the spermatic cord. In addition to the vas deferens, the cord carries three separate sources of arterial blood flow, the testicular artery that branches from the aorta below the renal artery, the cremasteric artery, and the deferential artery. Interruption of one of the arteries during vasectomy or inguinal surgery will not result in ischemia to the testis. The cremasteric artery is a branch of the inferior epigastric artery, and the deferential artery is a branch of the superior vesicular artery. There is no scrotal artery.
Which portion of the bladder is intraperitoneal? A. Dome only. B. Dome and body. C. Dome, body, and neck. D. None of the above.
The correct answer is D. None of the above. The urinary bladder is situated in the retropubic space in an extraperitoneal position. A portion of the bladder dome is adjacent to the peritoneum, so ruptures at this point can result in intraperitoneal urine leakage.
Hydrocele is formed between A. the external spermatic and cremasteric fascia. B. the cremasteric and internal spermatic fascia. C. the internal spermatic fascia and the parietal layer of the tunica vaginalis. D. the visceral and parietal layers of the tunica vaginalis.
The correct answer is D. the visceral and parietal layers of the tunica vaginalis. Beneath the skin of the scrotum, from superficial to deep, are the dartos, external spermatic cremasteric, and internal spermatic fascias. These layers are not always distinct. Beneath the internal fascia are the parietal and visceral layers of the tunica vaginalis, between which hydrocells form. The visceral layer of the tunica vaginalis is adherent to the testis.
Excellent, you passed the exam.
Thanks, doctor.
Thanks to you for watching this medical exam video. Hope you enjoy. Get benefits. We'll see you in more next videos. These videos for medical staff like medical students, doctors, undergraduate and postgraduate, nurses. So please subscribe to our YouTube channel. Number 1 Doctor. Like our videos. Share our video. Press alarm button to get notified about our new videos. Follow our accounts on social media in links below the video in the description. With my best wishes, Dr. Atef Ahmed.